Yeah. Turn with me to 1 Peter 1, and while you're turning there, I'd just like to take a moment just to thank you as a church for investing in the apprenticeship. It's been profitable. It's been encouraging. It's been a blessing sitting under the elders and learning from them has gotten the opportunity to do. So 1 Peter 1, chapter 1, verses 3 through 9. Peter writes, "Blessed be the God and Father of our Lord Jesus Christ. According to His great mercy, He has caused us to be born again to a living hope through the resurrection of Jesus Christ from the dead, to an inheritance that is imperishable, undefiled, unfading, and kept in heaven for you, who by God's power are being guarded through faith for a salvation ready to be revealed in the last time. In this you rejoice, though now, for a little while, if necessary, you have been grieved by various trials, so that the tested genuineness of your faith, which is more precious than gold that perishes though it is tested by fire, may be found to result in praise and glory and honor at the revelation of Jesus Christ. Though you have not seen Him, you love Him. And though you do not now see Him, you believe in Him and rejoice with joy that is inexpressible and filled with glory, obtaining the outcome of your faith, the salvation of your souls." Would you pray once more with me? Father, we come to You. Lord, so thankful that You have been so kind and gracious and merciful to us in Christ. And Lord, we pray and I ask, God, that You would be gracious to me now this morning. God, I pray that You would give me clarity of thought and clarity of speech. Lord, I pray, God, that You would lay Your word upon our hearts. Lord, I pray that it would encourage us and strengthen us, Lord, so that we might be able to endure the trials that lie before us. Lord, we pray this in the name of Christ. Amen. In 2011, just 7 months after I stole Chrismar away from you, Chrismar and I got married. There was a serious crime that was committed against us. It actually made national headlines. It was committed by someone that we welcomed into our home, someone that we thought was a brother, a co-laborer in the gospel. It was by someone that we trusted. And violating that trust, I mean, it was a hard time. I mean, we did not trust others. It even affected how we trusted each other. It affected how we trusted the Lord. It was a trying and difficult time in our lives. 7 months after that, only several weeks after I decided to leave a well-paying ministerial job to go and help a church plant out, Chrismar came back to bed at around 4 in the morning to tell me that she was pregnant. And that was good news, right? It would have been much better if she waited 3 hours or so for me to eat, drink some coffee, wake up. But nonetheless, it was good news, and I certainly did rejoice several hours later. But just that night, as you know, we were so excited. We wanted to call our families immediately, and so that night we called, and that very night, though, that excitement was kind of overshadowed by learning that a loved one was very sick, and that her care would fall to us, and so now our family was doubling in size, and our income was going to be cut in half, making matters much more difficult. Would be that the next year would go on to show that things are just not going to work out as far as my role was concerned in serving in that church plant. It's incredibly discouraging. So our time in Memphis, just like our time in Arkansas, proved to be a very trying, very difficult time in our lives. Then we moved here a little over a year ago, and I accepted a pastor at a small rural church out east of Jackson. And 5 months later, the church asked for my resignation due to some theological differences. Again, yet another discouraging and trying time. And then just a few months ago, you as a church actually walked with me through this. My father died. October 3rd, just the day before that we were going to announce to my family that we were expecting our second child, we learned of his passing. And the most difficult thing about that was that my father, unless he cried out in his last moments, he is under the eternal wrath of just God. These are various trials that I have and my wife, my family, have endured just over the last couple years. And so I must confess that, you know, when we had to turn in a sermon manuscript several weeks ago, I had selfish motivations in choosing this text. I wanted this text to wash over me, to encourage me as I prepared to preach it. But thankfully, because of the glorious sufficiency of Scripture, I know that this text will resonate and it will encourage you as well. I'm certain that each and every one of you has experienced suffering. You've experienced trials. You've experienced difficulties and hardships in your life. I share these trials in my life because I know that you have stories just like them. You too have experienced various trials. Many of you experienced trials of greater severity than my own. Perhaps in sharing mine, they brought some of yours to your mind. You know, many of you know what it is like to lose a loved one, to have miscarriage. I know just a few weeks ago, Chris was pregnant, which I kind of just announced. We haven't formally announced, so I guess this is it. she was showing a lot of signs of miscarriage. And as we began to share this with you as a church, man, people who had had miscarriage just been coming out of the woodwork. And that was, while we hate that you went through that, that was encouraging to us because we knew that you knew what we were going through. And you knew how to pray for us even better than we knew how to pray for ourselves. Thankfully, by the way, everything is looking great. And we're thankful to the Lord for that. So many of you know what it's like to lose loved ones, to experience miscarriages, to endure financial hardships. You know what it's like to be unemployed, perhaps. Maybe you've even experienced persecution in some way. There's so many things, right? These events or these circumstances may in those times or may even now cause you to doubt whether the Lord loves you, whether He's sovereign or whether He's good. Maybe it led you to feel, as I have in the past, discouragement, that you're alone, or despair. Perhaps it leaves you asking the age-old question, how can an all-powerful and all-loving and all-good God allow suffering in the world? When our text this morning, Peter is writing to such a people. He is writing to a people who are suffering. He writes to churches that were experiencing a vast array of trials. They were being persecuted not because Christianity was illegal, but because Christianity was exclusive. They lived in a time of tolerance where, yeah, it was okay to worship Christ, but you should also worship the emperor. You should also be accepting of emperor worship and the other religions. They lived in a time of tolerance. So Peter writes, under the inspiration of the Spirit, not only to them in their trials, but to us in ours as well. In Christ, we can joyfully endure suffering in this life because what is promised and what is prepared for us in the life to come. In Christ, we can joyfully endure suffering in this life because what is promised and what is prepared for us in the life to come. In our text this morning, I think we find five truths that are applied to those who are in Christ and who are suffering that can help sustain us in the time of trial. First is that in Christ, we have new life. Look at verse 3. Peter writes, "Blessed be the God and Father of our Lord Jesus Christ. According to His great mercy, He has caused us to be born again." We find Peter blessing God for causing us to be born again. Notice he's using the same language that Jesus uses when he's speaking with Nicodemus in John chapter 3. The language isn't, it's not accidental, it's not flippant, it's very intentional. What Peter is saying and what Jesus was saying is that they're using that language to show our inability in attaining new life on our own merits, our own knowledge. No one apart from Christ has ever had anything to do with the timing or their achieving their own birth. I know growing up as a kid, brother and sister, my brother was born in June, sister was born in July. They had pool parties as a kid for their birthday. I was born in September, so school had started, and it was starting to get a little colder, and you know, you still have pool parties in September. I didn't get to choose my birthday. Likewise, we who trust in Christ, we were elect before the foundations of the world, not according to the will of man, but according to God's foreknowledge. We see that if you look back up just in verses 1 and 2, Peter's writing, he says, to those who are elect exiles, so they're elect, verse 2, according to the foreknowledge of God the Father. Now, a common misunderstanding about foreknowledge at this point is God looks into the future through the corridors of history, and He looks at those who would be accepting of Him, who would love Him, who would be obedient to Him, and then He elects them based on their election of Him. Essentially, I think what that means is that God looks through the corridors of history and He looks at those who loved Him first. We know we love because Christ first loved us. And so His foreknowledge is not merely God knowing what's going to happen in the future. It's not Him responding to what we are going to do in the future. It is God's act of setting His affections on us in advance. He causes us to be born again. So Peter, he blesses God according to His mercy. He sets His affections on us and causes us to be born again. He gives us new life, all accomplished through the gospel, the perfect life, the atoning death, and the victorious resurrection of Jesus Christ our Lord. This isn't a perfect illustration, but it's one I'm going to refer to throughout the rest of our time together. There's a father seeking to adopt a child, and he begins surveying profiles. He stops over years. He sees you're several years old, but you know, you're not potty trained yet. You're extremely rebellious and high maintenance, and every parent said, "What child isn't?" But he wishes to visit with you. He looks over you. He sees you in your mess. And he chooses you. He adopts you. He takes you by the hand. He carries your baggage and the other. And begins taking you on a long journey home. You've been given a new life. You're no longer an orphan. You are now living the life of a son and a daughter. This is what the Lord has done for us. He has given us new life. But this isn't all that the Lord has done for us. Number two, we see in Christ we have a living hope. Again, look at verse 3. He has caused us to be born again to a living hope through the resurrection of Jesus Christ from the dead. And the question I want to try to answer here is what does Paul mean by a living hope? And today, in our culture today, the way we kind of use the word hope is to kind of like a meaning of a wishful thinking, right? So I may say, I hope that Notre Dame wins the national championship next year. I can't say that this year because they have no chance. So I may say that. So when I say I hope that they, or I may say to jest with my dear brother Logan, I hope that the Chicago Cubs do not win a single game next year. When I'm saying that, what I'm not saying is I expect Notre Dame to win the national championship next year, because I don't, unfortunately. What I'm saying is I would like for Notre Dame to win next year. I would like for that to happen. I'm not saying I have an assurance or I have a confidence or I expect that that will happen. So when Peter says that we've been born again to a living hope through Christ's resurrection, he's not saying that we have been born again to some uncertainty, something that we hope, that we wish would happen. He's saying we have been born again and can have full assurance that God is going to do good to us in the future. He has secured our own resurrection. This hope is it's a confidence, it's an assurance. And I think we can know this, that that's what he means by hope, because of what the author of Hebrews writes in chapter 6, verse 11. It says, "And we desire each one of you to show the same earnestness, to have the full assurance of hope until the end." So hope is not, it's not wishful thinking as used today, but it is an assurance and confidence that God intends good for us. And it is a living hope because it is confidence and assurance that was secured through our living and resurrected Lord. And this hope is in fact Christ himself. So I think that what Peter is saying is that this hope, which is eternity with Christ, is secured through his resurrection. We're going to be raised as he was, though he died, he rose again. We too, though we will die, we will be raised again. And revisiting my illustration of the father adopting us as children, as we're on this long journey home, he begins to speak to us. And he begins to reveal himself to us. He begins telling us what life with him is going to be like. And he begins telling us about the home to which he's taking us. Hearing this, we're filled with hope. We're filled with an expectation of what home is going to be like and what life with our Father is going to be like. And the glorious thing about this is that he offers us more than just this hope of future resurrection. Number three, and again, sorry I haven't mentioned it. Sorry for the writing as well, but my points are on the board if you can read them. Number three, in Christ, we have an everlasting inheritance. Verse 4, Peter writes, "To an inheritance that is imperishable, undefiled, and unfading, kept in heaven for you." So when God called Abraham, he promised him an inheritance. And he promised his descendants an inheritance. It was the promised land. But the promised land was an earthly inheritance. It was not an eternal inheritance. And it was not an everlasting inheritance. Peter uses three words to describe ours. First, he says that our inheritance is imperishable, while the Israelites' inheritance was perishable. Consider Isaiah 24:3, which says, The earth shall be utterly empty and utterly plundered, for the Lord has spoken this word. Isaiah 24:6 would go on to say that a curse devours the earth. We know that heaven and earth shall pass away, but the word of the Lord will not pass away. Yet eternal inheritance that Peter is speaking of is imperishable. It will always remain. It will never perish. Secondly, he mentions that our inheritance is undefiled. The Israelites' inheritance was defiled. It was defilable. Isaiah 24:5 says that the earth lies defiled. Jeremiah 2:7 says, "And I brought you into a plentiful land to enjoy its fruits and its good things, but when you came in, you defiled my land and made my heritage an abomination." In contrast, again, the inheritance we have in Christ is undefiled. It will never spoil or go bad. While the Israelites were unfaithful and defiled the land, Christ's faithfulness covers our unfaithfulness, and our inheritance will remain undefiled. And then thirdly, he says that our inheritance is unfading. Jeremiah 23:10 speaks of the land mourning and its pastures and wilderness being dried up. Isaiah 24:4 speaks of the earth withering. Perhaps many of you have memorized Isaiah 48, the grass withers, the flower fades, but the word of the Lord will remain undefiled. So, I just misquoted a verse that I have memorized. The word of the Lord will not pass away. The inheritance is sure, and it is everlasting. Now imagine that you have, someone has come and told you that you have this inheritance check. This inheritance check is of infinite monetary value. The check will never be voided. Its value can never decrease. The amount of the check can never be placed into another account, so its value cannot be stolen from you. There's this check. But there's a problem. The check lies unguarded. And it lies on display in the town square of the largest, most populated city in the world. And while it can't be voided, it can't be ripped up, it can't be corrupted, its value be placed in another person's account, you'd be pretty sure that you'll never see that check. Now, thankfully, that's not the case with the inheritance that Peter speaks of. Peter says that our inheritance is not unguarded, and neither are we. Look at verse 5. It says, who, by God's power, are being guarded through faith for a salvation ready to be revealed in the last time. We see in verse 5 that our inheritance is in the best hands. Some of you may be insured by Allstate, and maybe they have good hands, but there are better. God's power is guarding us and our inheritance through our faith. And that may be kind of unnerving to think, well, God, if God's power is guarding us through our faith, what if our faith fails? What if it stumbles? What if down the road 20 years from now we lose our faith? What if my faith grows weak? Well, it may seem like so much rests on your ability to exercise faith. But we can rest because this is how God's power guards our inheritance. He guards it by sustaining our faith. He is the one who upholds our faith. And we can trust that tomorrow, the next day, years from now, He will continue to guard us by sustaining our faith. God is keeping the inheritance for you, and God is keeping you for the inheritance. Your inheritance is safe, and so are you. We also see in this verse that our salvation is going to be revealed in the last time. We often think of our salvation looking back as a past event, but it's also a future reality. Yes, we now have the remission of sins, but we're still going to struggle with sin until Christ returns. Yes, now we are adopted as children, but sometimes we act like rebels. Yes, now we're indwelled by the Spirit, but sometimes we neglect His guidance. I think 1 John 3:2 might also be helpful in understanding this tension. The Apostle John writes, "Beloved, we are God's children now. And what we will be has not yet appeared, but what we know is that when He appears, we shall be like Him, because we shall see Him as He is." So our salvation is a future reality. It's yet another gift that in the midst of trial, in the midst of suffering, in the midst of hardship, we can look forward to with great anticipation and rejoicing until it's realized. This is call for rejoicing. Returning to the adoption story that I've mentioned several times, you know, as we're on this long journey home, and our Father speaking to us. He speaks of an inheritance. And as he's telling us about how wonderful this inheritance is, this is a fallen world. We may begin to think, well, what if it's gone by the time we get there? Or what if someone steals it? Or, you know, economy's bad. What if that has some effect on it and it's gone? Well, again, our inheritance is secure. And then also in regards to our salvation, our adoption, you know, he's on our long journey there, and we're going to stumble, we're going to make mistakes, we're going to be messy. Our baggage is going to be heavy. But he's not going to turn around and return us. Our salvation is also secured. So, number four, in Christ, we can rejoice in suffering. Verse 6, he says, in this you rejoice, though now for a little while, if necessary, you've been grieved by various trials. The question I want to answer here is in what? In what is Peter saying that we can rejoice in the midst of suffering? If we're going to endure various trials, if we're going to suffer, what is it that we can cling to? What is it Peter's referencing that we can have unflinching and unyielding joy in a world filled with death and cancer, hate and racism, crime, murder, war? What could be cause for rejoicing? Well, I think it's the very truths that Peter's been reminding us of thus far. That the Lord so loves us that He sets His affections on us, that He's caused us to be born again. He's given us a new life, that even though we were rebels, He's not only accepting of us in Christ, but He calls us sons and daughters. And He gives us inheritance that is imperishable and it's unfading and undefiled. An inheritance of infinite value, which is Himself. And though we may face hardship and pain and suffering and heartbreak, and though we may be pressed on every side, we can rejoice because Christ is our inheritance, and it is eternity with Christ that awaits us. So in our trials, we cling to the gospel. We cling to His life, death, and resurrection, that our sin is applied to Him and His righteousness is applied to us. We can rejoice, though now, for a little while, we experience various trials. And you know, when Peter says that we're going to experience trials for a little while, it doesn't mean that those trials are going to be a short segment in our life. We may endure short seasons of trials, but we may also experience a lifetime of trials. We may experience a lifetime of suffering. So what Peter means, and this is a glorious truth, is that even if we do experience a lifetime of trials, it will be but a momentary affliction compared to eternity with Christ. So when trials come, though they may be painful and hard to endure, we can do so with joy because of what lies before us. Number 5, in Christ, our faith is refined for His glory. Verse 7, so that the tested genuineness of your faith, which is more precious than gold that perishes though it is tested by fire, may be found to result in the praise and glory and honor at the revelation of Jesus Christ. Now, I think this verse answers a question that may emerge in our minds in a time of trial. I think it's a question that actually emerges in the minds of many unbelievers. Well, let's address believers first. Yes, we may be thinking in a time of trial. Yes, the Lord has caused us to be born again. Yes, He's caused us to be born again to a living hope and an everlasting inheritance. Yes, our suffering may be momentary afflictions compared to eternity, but why do we suffer at all? Why does the Lord, in His gracious providence, allow suffering? This verse says, He does so to refine our faith for His glory. A tested faith, and one that proves to be genuine, results in the praise and the glory and the honor of Christ. Now, trials are the medium through which, if trials are the way in which God works to refine our faith, to grow our faith, to mature our faith, are we bold enough to pray for greater faith? I know many times that I've prayed for greater faith. I know I prayed for faith that would marvel the Savior. But when I would pray that, it was really kind of at little or no cost, other than the time I spent and the words I used to ask for it. But what this verse says is that when we are asking for that, we're essentially asking, Lord, send trials my way, refine my faith so that You may be glorified. Are we bold enough to pray in that way? As I conclude this morning, again, I want to say that I know that all of you have grieved trials. You've all endured tests. You've all experienced trials. Perhaps those have shaken your faith at times. Or perhaps it's again, caused you to doubt God's goodness and His sovereignty and His love for you. But if you are in Christ, if you have placed your faith in Christ, then you have been born again to a living hope and an everlasting inheritance. And because of that hope and because of that inheritance, we can rejoice in suffering that the Lord is using to refine our faith for His glory. In Christ, we can joyfully endure suffering because of what is promised to us, because of what has been prepared for us in the life to come. And before I pray, I want to revisit my illustration one last time of the Father adopting us. As we journey on side by side, the walk will at times seem difficult. Will seem like there are many trials before us. There will be many uphill battles and slippery slopes. It will seem treacherous. There may seem like there's obstacles that are too great for us. May even feel lonely at times. But our Father is near. He will sustain you. He will see you through. And in that, we can rejoice, though now for a little while. Our pilgrimage to home may seem like a lifetime of trials. It too shall pass, and it's going to give way to an eternity of delight. Would you pray with me? Father, I pray once more, as I have so many times this week, God, that Your Word would be such an encouragement and such a refreshment to the weary. God, that Your Word, Lord, and these things that we see in this text, God, would strengthen us in the midst of our trials. Lord, that we would cast our eyes upon You. And Lord, as we run our race, God, though it may hurt, it may be painful, and though it may be hard at times, God, I pray that we would always be faithful to look ahead and to see the worth of Christ and to what He has planned and prepared for us. Lord, I pray now for our service that we're about to dismiss into. God, I pray for my brother Lee as he preaches. I pray that You speak through him. And Lord, I pray, God, that as we worship You, You would be pleased with our offering of worship. And Lord, we love You. We pray this in the name of Christ.